name is Michael George Bratnick, age 65. I'm retired from the Internal Revenue Service. Been retired now for 3 years, and I don't do much.
My name is Elizabeth Reginelli, Betty for short, and I'm 77 years old. I've been retired for 12 years now, and what I do for fun now is puzzles, mainly, and...
My name is Alan Bratnick, I'm 57, and I work at University Hospitals of Cleveland as a manager in medical records.
OTC actually was not created by me, it was created by my friend Bruce Williams. And it originated, it stands for Out the Country. And Bruce, back in September of 1965, watched this program called OK Crackerby, O period, K period, Crackerby. And it was a sitcom based upon Burl Ives was the main character. And he was the richest man in the world. He was an oil tycoon. And BF saw this show. It didn't last very long. It only lasted like 5 months before it was canceled. But he loved the fact that this guy used his first two initials instead of his name. And he thought that that was a rich-sounding thing. So he started calling himself BF, Bruce Frank, and he started calling me MG. He further went on to call different things initials so that we could be talking about something in front of someone else and they wouldn't know what we were talking about. For example, he called my mother OL, which stands for old lady. And then another thing was OTC, out the country. We always called it, my mother called it out the country, not out in the country or out to the country. It was always out the country. So that's how the OTC acronym started, from Bruce Williams.
Okay, it's in Middlefield, Ohio, which is east of Lake Ladue Reservoir, off of 422 and 88. My grandfather used to live there in the corner house off of Old State Road. And then prior to that, he lived at the old Bundysburg farm, which is about 2 miles north of that.
The very first OTC is located in Hamden Township. And I found it originally when I was doing my genealogy research, and I came up with an ad of that my grandfather placed in a Cleveland Plain Dealer in 1924, selling this 54-acre property. And the more research I did, I found out that he bought this property in 1920 and sold it in 1924, and it had a sugar bush on it. He made maple syrup on this farm. It was in two plots. The southern part was sold to a developer who made it into a trailer park. The northern part is still there, and there's a house on it, but no one's lived there in several years. It's very deserted. The second OTC is on Bundysburg Road and Old State Route, and it's maybe a 3 or 4 minute drive from the OTC that I grew up on. Now that's the one that was sold in approximately 1955. It was purchased in 1926 by my grandfather. And right now the Amish own it. Unfortunately, the house is torn down, the barn is torn down, the granary is torn down, and the garage is torn down. So there's nothing there that would be anything reminiscent of what my sister had when she grew up there.
My memories of that are the guys coming over on every Sunday, uncles and aunts and everybody else, and the guys would play poker on a table underneath the tree and listen to the ball games. I remember all that, and I remember my grandmother cooking, and she would always make me bread and jelly, bread and butter and jelly when I'd come there. And she made strudel, which covered the whole table. It was a huge table, and I don't know how she ever did it, but She made delicious strudel, and this was all on a coal stove or a wood stove. And I know that she had the iron getting warm on the top of the stove because there was no electricity in the farm. And they had a pump in the kitchen where you pump water to drink water or wash or whatever. And we had an outhouse that we had to go to, which was great. But that farm is now torn down, the barn is torn down, and all the memories are gone now. I guess they sold the farm in 1955, and at that time I was 15 years old, so that's what I remember. And I didn't go there too much as a teenager, and except when going with my girlfriends, and we would, you know, jump in the hayloft and do things like that. My brothers are much younger than I am, so they are used to the new farm.
Well, I've always known them to live at the Old State Road farm, and we would go there to visit. We would go there usually on Sunday mornings after church. We would drive out and have a brief visit with my grandfather in the house. I just remember walking into the home. He would be sitting in this room off to the side and just sitting there talking with my father. He didn't speak English very well, so I don't remember speaking with him in a conversation or asking him questions because he wouldn't have really understood what I was asking. But my father would speak to him in Croatian, part English, I guess, broken. And so we would meet and have a brief visit with them there for maybe half hour, hour, after which then we would walk out to the woods and usually have a cookout. We'd either bring bologna sandwiches or build a fire and have hot dogs and drink pop. We would pick up on the way over to the farm, stop at Lawson's and pick up lunch meat. We'd pick up bologna, mustard, bread, or hot dogs, and just have a little picnic there.
So we'd go every other Sunday, and it's just a general, I just have a happy feeling about OTC because it was, we would go out there, we'd see my grandfather. I can just picture myself in the kitchen, Uncle Nick, my father's brother would be on one side. He'd be rolling up his, he was the last person I knew that rolled his own cigarettes. My father would be on the left side and my grandfather would be on the opposite side of the table from me. And they would sit and talk before we went out to play with my cousins.
And I just have memories of walking into the house. I would often smell potatoes boiling. Uncle Nick would be making a meal for them, but distinctly remember in particular potatoes being boiled, and I can still remember that smell, as well as the old musty smell on the front porch. He had a big rain barrel that kind of sat outside the door and collected water from that rolled off the roof into the gutters, and just had a musty smell. And there's a little couch out on the porch, and they would sit there, talk a little bit, and that's kind of a distinctive memory.
Well, neither of them spoke English, so it was very hard to communicate. And besides that, I was young. I was like, you know, like 5, 6, 7, 8 when I went there, and you know, children don't talk too much. And then as I got older, I mean, they loved me and everything, I would assume, just different than it is today.
Mm-hmm. Didn't have a very close relationship with any of my grandparents, actually. They spoke very broken English. We couldn't just sit down and have a conversation. It'd have to be an interpreter through my father or uncle. So it was very superficial. I mean, what we talked about, how are you doing, you know, what are you doing in school, that type of thing. But it was no real relationship other than that.
He was very gentle. He was older to me. I don't know how old he was at the time. He had to be in his 70s, so it was tough for him to get around. He had a little limp to his step. So I just know him being in that home and kind of remember just him sitting down there in that chair in that one room that he would sit in often, or walk out to or the milk house or the old barn, but he never really came back, at least that often, to the sled riding hill where we'd have our picnics.
Well, it was usually around maybe about 7 or 8, because I can't remember, before that. And we would go walk down the pathway to get to where the cow pasture was. And my grandfather would, lead us, and all the cousins and stuff, which were older than I, walked down there too. And he would say, "Come, boss, come, boss." And the cows would come, and then we'd follow the cows back home into the barn. When we went there on Sundays, there was a whole bunch of people that came there, relatives and stuff, and we could play croquet on the side of the barn where there was a big field, or baseball, or some of the other stuff like that. And there were a lot of times where we had picnics with my mom's and dad's friends, and we would take everything, go back to the cow pasture and into the woods, right the outskirts of the woods in the back, and they would play polka music and dance and have build a fire, and the kids would play and swing on the vines, and there was a mound there that we thought it was an Indian mound and was stacks of stones on top, and we always wanted to go back there and uncover it, but we never did. So it was fun memories.
I just remember I had 6 cousins, my Uncle Nick's kids, Kathy, Julie, Linda, Barbara, Nikki, Jeannie, and it was like a built-in neighborhood whenever I went there. We didn't have very many kids growing up in our neighborhood, but when I went out there, it was like having a bunch of friends already there.
But we would walk out to the woods, walk through the fields. We would often, the grass was so high you can hide there and play hide and seek into the grass. We would walk to the sled riding hill, and that's where we'd set up a campfire. There's a place to set up a campfire for a cookout or just a brief lunch with some rocks and old stones to sit on. Just to the right of that was an old garbage pit. So all the trash and garbage and old appliances and so forth would be thrown in there. And it's just kind of bad, actually. After that, I would enjoy walks down to the down the hill and along the creek. There was a shale-bedded creek that we would follow, and along the way, hills from the erosion of the creek. We would often climb up the roots that were sticking out of there. I remember in particular there was a kind of a round root that grew around it. It was like a seat. I would often crawl up there and just sit in that. And there was a vine at one particular point that looked like a smiley face. My brother called it the natural hammock. And we would just swing on that and just have fun walking through the woods, especially in the fall.
Occasionally I would bring friends, I would bring BF, and my fun thing to do with BF was to, he had slingshots and he had M80s, and he would put slingshots, or the M80 in the slingshot, and shoot it up in the air, light it, and we would blast in the air, or we would put the M80s into anthills. I remember bringing my friend Susie across the street. She went there one time, and she was so disgusted by the way OTC looked. Like, it wasn't what she pictured. She says, "I thought OTC would be meadows and wildflowers, and here there was a dilapidated barn and an old house and mosquitoes and bugs." And she never went again because she thought it was not what she had pictured a countryside to be.
A couple times we spent the night there, and there was no electricity, like I said before, and there was a kerosene lamp, and everybody would be sitting around the table after supper and talking or whatever, and then went to bed. There's nothing else to do at night. Look at the stars.
Back when I was 8 or 9, I wanted to camp out in the worst way, OTC, with my father. So we somehow got a tent and sleeping bags, and we found an area that we camped in, that we started to camp in. But in the middle of the night, more like probably 10 or 11 o'clock at night, I was afraid of dinosaurs. So we left. And the reason The reason we're, I was afraid of dinosaurs is because we found in this creek bed, we found this depression. It looked like a bowl in the creek bed in shale. It was hard, you know, rock. And my father said, those look like mastodon footprints. And so I just thought that there were still mastodons around. So around 10 or 11 or whatever time it was at night, we had to pick up our equipment and head back home because I was afraid.
Going over there with my father and brother, there was a point, it had to be after 1965, because I remember the 65 Ford, we would drove that Ford over to the point where the sled riding hill was, and we set up camp. And I remember my dad's getting some plastic sheeting, setting up some branches, and then just draping the plastic sheeting over the branches so we could camp out overnight. And I remember the headlights from the car being illuminated inside of the tent at night as we needed it to. So that was the only time that we actually camped out there, and that was with my dad and my brother.
OTC means a lot to with my wife Janice, because we camped there once in maybe 1973-74 era. We camped on the top of the hill, and also we had our prom picnic there, and I said my famous line there that helped solidify Janice to marrying me. We had our picnic lunch in front of us, and on the plate was some beans. The beans were on a slight tilt because of the terrain, and I said to her, beans always seek their lowest level. She thought that was hilarious when I said that, and she says, I think I'm gonna marry this guy. So it means a lot. OTC means a lot.
And oh, I remember my two uncles coming back from the Army in, I guess it was 1945. That was when I was 5 years old, so I remember that, and everybody was cheering and singing when Johnny comes marching home, and they brought home some gifts for souvenirs for everyone. And I still have a handkerchief that my Uncle John gave me. It was a little parachuter. He was in the Air Force, and it's a little hanky with a parachute on it.
Well, a couple memories actually stand out, but we had a boat one time. The water level at the little pond that was down there that went under the road was at varying degrees of height. So we were, at one point it was fairly high, so we were able to get a little boat there and get into the canoe or boat, whatever it was, and then go under the cul-de-sac, or the drain pipe rather. And I remember a snake dropping down off from the side of the pipe onto the boat, which was kind of interesting, but that was fun. And as well as we brought my dog out, Thunder, one time. Unfortunately, he got loose and I thought he was going to be gone for good, but we were finally able to round him up. And I felt so bad because as we were getting him into the car, the door was closed and it closed on his tail. It's like, I felt so bad.
There was a period of time of 1 year when my grandfather lived in this milk house on OTC. And I asked my father why he moved into the milk house, and it's because he said my grandpa didn't have enough money to keep the farm and to pay the taxes. So he moved into the milk house and had some other family rent the house while he lived there. There was no running water. He had a little potbelly stove for heat. And of course, went to the bathroom where he went to the bathroom, who knows where. And so that was a sad time in my life when we went over there, and all he had was a bed and this potbelly stove and place to cook.
The Bundysburg farm, we didn't really stop there that often. We would go there occasionally just to ask my dad questions about where he grew up. So we might pull in the driveway, but We never really stopped and got out and walked around the property for him to kind of discuss it in detail. It wasn't until after the previous owners left the property or sold it or was up for sale that we actually walked onto the property. I remember taking a trip out there with my Uncle John, and he took us through and showed us the barn, and we were able actually to go into the house because it was up for sale at that point. So we took a tour of the home and looked at the kitchen, the bedrooms, and we were able to take a few things from the home as like memorabilia, like hooks and door knobs and so forth. And we went out to the barn and saw where my sister would jump from the rafters into piles of hay. And then finally the Amish bought the property. And we had gone back there periodically just to visit and see the property. So we've developed a friendship with the Bylers to the point where we can go there and walk the property and kind of see where my father and grandparents lived. And what's kind of interesting is I remember my dad telling me that they would make maple syrup from the trees on that farm. And fortunately, the Amish now have a big production of maple syrup from that area. So it's nice to go there and purchase the maple syrup for use for our family.
My grandfather died in 1973, and in his will, he stipulated that the farm be divided up such that my Uncle Nick, who was divorced and had nowhere, he lived there, had nowhere else to go, he got the house and a little bit of property around the house. The rest of the siblings got the land. So I was sad. I mean, I understood why he did that, of course. It provided a place for him to live. But I was sad in that the property was divided up, and I knew my parents wouldn't want the land, or neither would any of the other siblings. So we ended up selling it. It was sad. I mean, I would have liked to have kept it in the family, someplace to go on weekends and things, but I know it wasn't practical. We couldn't, even if the house was there, it would be impossible to keep up with the repairs on that huge house. First of all, the house doesn't look anything like it used to because of the fact that they redid it. And to see it in such disrepair is very sad. When I see Bundysburg, I especially get sad because the house is torn down and the barn is torn down. And even though it wasn't a part of my youth, I feel more connected to that property than any of the three OTC places. And it's probably because they lived there for so long. They owned it from 26 to about 1955. And to think that that's, my father grew up there, and my uncles and aunts, and that's where they made their living. It's sad to see nothing there anymore. It's like my history is destroyed. So, yes, I do have regrets about going back there.
Thank you. put like ice and stuff in the floor and it kept it cool. That's where my father used to play the banjo and the ukulele. I guess he said the acoustics were good in that milk house. And that, then the milk wagon used to come down here, go into the milk house and take the milk from the today's yield and put it in their truck.
Okay.
All right, when are you gonna try?
This is the foundation of the house.
Probably a chimney over there. There's a lot of, the house has collapsed on itself. I would do it by the tree and by the barn. Lunchtime, come eat.
Ring the bell.
That hill was where the barn was, behind it.
Yeah.
And it went down.
Yeah.
And the hill was so that you could drive the horses or the tractors and stuff up there. And then when you went on down that path down there, there's a pond or something down there where they used to get water from, and then you'd walk down to the right and back up there to the pasture when we used to walk up to the pasture.
There's the outhouse, right here. This is what's called a granary, and what was here was they'd harvest their corn and stuff and store it in the granary and then feed it to the animals throughout the winter. It was tall. They had like an upstairs to it. This is where Grandpa lived for a whole year.
This is actually where Grandpa lived?
Yep. And I remember visiting. He had the stove pipe, potbelly stove was here with the thing out the window. He had a bed somewhere in here. Of course, the cracks weren't there. And this is where, I mean, he had a...
stove or something.
A little, yeah, heater plate. And he lived here for a whole year.
This was not here before.
Are we going to go look for that tree with the...
Well, as soon as she comes back. Is it, what's that?
We're going to go up to the hill?
Yeah. Well, wait a minute. Is this kind of where it was?
Right through here.
Where's the trash pit?
It's all changed.
Oh, they re-landscaped those.
Yeah. This is the trash pit right here. Right in here.
So we were on the other side then. That's where that hill was, where that big tree is.
Yeah. This is the hill. And it still looks pretty steep.
Yeah. So where was the tree that we swung on? Is it this one?
Yeah, I think it is.
That seems kind of small. But there was a big branch that came out. Maybe it was like this branch. And I remember swinging on the rope here.
And you hit your eyes.
And I was probably showing off to my friends. I was swinging. I slipped off the rope and fell down. There was broken glass and I cut my eyebrow.
Probably broken glass from the pit.
We're up here with the Ford, the 65 Ford, and it was right by these trees.
Daddy pulled the car up.
Yeah.
And we had plastic. He used plastic and made a tent out of plastic.
Yeah, I remember that.
And then we'd have to walk through, you know, shoulder high grass to get over to this point. We'd walk in here, it opened up into the trees then. Over to that side, that's where all the trash bin was, right down in that area.
Nitro hammock was a vine. It came from one tree, and it broke into two vines, and then it went back into one again. So it looked like a hammock.
So this is where my brother carved his initials in here, Mike. And then we put our initials in over here on the left afterwards. So you could see Dad and Alan, and then Nick Bratnick, our cousin, put his initials in there.
Wonderful memories. Although I was still mostly young when it happened.
The best thing I had was being with my father, because growing up, my father worked evening shift. He worked from 3 to 11:30. So during the school year, when I went to school, he was sleeping from the night before. When I came home from school, he was at work. So the only time I saw him was on the weekends. So it was kind of a special time for us to get together. The first time I ever drove was OTC. He let me sit on his lap and we drove down this old dirt road, Hosmer Road in OTC. I remember stopping in Chagrin Falls on the way to OTC in the fall, and we'd sit there, he'd turn off the car and we'd breathe in the smell of the burning leaves from the cities, from the citizens in Chagrin Falls.
It's just the overall memory of my childhood going there as a kid and enjoying the woods, developing a love for nature, and just kind of family history.
I think going OTC is just a period of my life where I was happy. It was youthful innocence and just no worries and just having fun with my cousins and spending a time with my father. So it was just a period that was very, very happy in my life that I sometimes wish I had back.